Today we are going to talk about one of the most famous stories ever written in the Bible. And the story comes from the passage of Matthew chapter 14, verse 23 to 23. That is Jesus talking about. Now, this morning there are going to be some important lessons that God wants us to learn this morning when we decide to trust Him with the challenges we are going to face today. Now, right now, all that we are deep into this story. So, the story of Jesus walking on water was right after Jesus had come from one of the most miraculous things that he has ever done, which was feeding 5,000 people with 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish only. To be honest, I don't know how big or small the size of this, but 2 fish is not enough for me. Now, so, if you guys have your Bibles, can you please turn to Matthew chapter 14? Matthew chapter 14. So, if you're there, I'll be reading from verse 23 to 33, which says, after he had dismissed them, he went up on a mountainside by himself to pray. Later that night, he was there alone, and the boat was already a considerable distance from him, buffeted by waves because the wind was against it. Shortly before dawn, Jesus went up to them, walking on the lake. When the disciples saw him walking in the lake, they were terrified. "It's a ghost," they said, and cried out in fear. But Jesus immediately said to them, "Take courage, it is I, do not be afraid." "Lord, if it is you," Peter said, "tell me to come to you in the water." "Come," Jesus said. Then Peter got down out of the boat, walked on the water, and came towards Jesus. But when he saw the man, he was afraid and began to sink. Cried out, "Lord, save me!" Immediately, Jesus reached out his hand and caught him. "You of little faith," he said, "why did you doubt?" And when they climbed into the boat, the wind died down, and then those who were in the boat worshipped him, saying, "Truly, you are the Son of God." Dear Heavenly Father, we come before you in awe, saying thank you for giving us the opportunity to spread your word, and thank you for allowing us to minister in word. Our Father, we invite you, Holy Spirit, with us, as we hear from you, Lord. When you speak to us, when you understand your word, and when you apply it in our lives. In Jesus' mighty name, we pray and believe. Amen. The title of this morning is One Small Step. Can you please repeat after me? One Small Step. That's it. Now, today we will reflect on how Peter took that one small step of faith and walked in water. In this story that we just read, we are told that the disciples were on a ship, in a boat, in the middle of the sea, and the waves were suddenly tossing around their boat. Into the sunlit from the sea. Now, as for sin, I'm sure that Peter and the other disciples knew how dangerous the sea can get when strong winds blow and turbulent waves can be the boat. So, being human, I suspect they were gripped with fear and trying to find the best to keep themselves from tipping over. Now, as they were trying to keep themselves afloat, they suddenly saw a figure of a person walking in water. So obviously they were afraid. Thinking that it was a ghost, he called out in fear. But little did they know that the person who was walking in water was Jesus. And so, at that moment, they were panicking. Jesus spoke up to them to calm them down by saying, "Take courage, it is I. And not afraid." So the statement happened to calm them down. And then at the moment, Peter decides to do something unthinkable, something that no other human being ever thinks of. That is, "Lord, if it is you, tell me to come to you to the water." Honestly, it's a strange request, right? Now, want you to see one more thing. We don't need just to put on the water ministry. We don't need just to do this ministry. But we first ask Jesus to allow him to step in the boat, to step out of the boat and walk in the water to the sea. And Jesus gave him the go ahead, which said, come. So that's what Peter did. So Peter got out of the boat and started walking in the water to Jesus. Yes, Peter was the only one who walked in the water, while all the other disciples just deep in the water. I mean, to be honest, Peter could have just waited for Jesus in the boat and take the other disciples to. But what we see here is that Peter had chosen to do something bold and courageous by taking that one small step of faith to step out of it and walk on one towards Jesus. Now, could you imagine how Peter must have felt when he was walking on water? I'm sure it must have been shocking and exciting for him at the same time, given that he was able to do something humanly impossible like walking on water. This is a great faith moment for him. I'm sure at that moment, all Peter could have heard was the voice of Jesus saying, take care, it is I, do not be afraid. And Jesus saying, come. And that is what he did. He got out of the boat and walked on the water. But as Peter walked towards Jesus, he suddenly gets distracted by what is happening around him. He sees the strong winds and the high waves around him, which causes him to be scared and frightened. Therefore, he takes his eyes and focus on Jesus, who is the only one who sustains him when walking through the water. So, as a result of this, Peter is drowning. He drowns because of his fear raised in self-doubt. Peter obviously must have thought that, how can I be walking on water while there's strong winds and heavy waves coming towards me? And at the moment, that's when he lost his focus, lost his eyes and his Jesus, and decided to think of the problems which is happening around him. But if you ask me, when we do the same thing in our daily lives, whether it is in our workplaces, whether it's in our relationships, or whether it's in school, we do take our eyes off of Jesus, and instead we focus on our problems. And as a result, we find ourselves drowning in fear, self-doubt, and rage. May God help us not to take our eyes off of Him. Amen. Amen. But when we take our eyes off of Jesus and start drowning, we are still able to cry out to God like Peter did. The Bible tells us that when Peter started drowning, he cried out to the Lord Jesus, saying, Lord, save me. And immediately, Jesus reached out to Peter, pulled him by his own hand, and brought him to the boat. This reminds us to seek the Lord whenever we are drowned in our fears, self-doubt, and guilt. Last but not least, I also imagine how the other disciples felt after seeing Peter walking on water together with Jesus. After seeing them missed out a big opportunity on sharing the same experience with Jesus when walking on water and talking to him. And the only reason why they missed out on such a good opportunity is because they were unwilling to take that one small step of faith like what Peter did. So maybe you're asking me, or you're asking yourself, how can I take that one small step of faith and trust in God to walk through these fears, self-doubt, or regrets that I have in my life, or that you have in your life? Well, we have the answer to that. So, today, we will hear some real stories from some of our teachings in youth about how they take small steps of faith to perform their self-doubt, their fear, and their regrets in their life. Please welcome the teachers and teachers.
My name is Ellen Pandaxia, and I'm from the preaching class. Today I'm talking about fear and my experiences with it. Now, ask yourself what fear is to you, and I'll continue. Fear is real, and I fear the dark, specifically being alone in a dark place. The dark makes me feel unsafe when I'm on the room floor. But with a person in the room, I feel as though I am distracted from the fear. Or hopefully the monster will be damaged in time to the night. How I keep myself grounded is I do my usual nightly prayer, Psalm chapter 22, verse 1 to 6. But I ask my Father in heaven to look after me. After that, I read and keep my Bible and Bible prayer. One, to know that the Word of God is with me, and two, to strive through the mentor. But in total, the Word of God keeps me grounded, mentally stable, and keeps my mind grounded to three points. You are alive, you are safe, and you will not die in the name of Jesus. Remember that fear is in your mind, so keep God on your mind with all the best things of your life. My name is Ashton Tuckinson, and I'm in Stephen's class, and I will be talking about my experience. I used to feel fear for my serious injury. I was afraid of flying. Two, I have a large form of epilepsy and disorder on both of eyes and not this thing. But I pray the Lord for my family prayed with me that I get to enjoy activity just in any other time. I got the courage to scream because, well, my twin sister is always with me in the water. My mom would always be right there and collect that even though she can't see. Oh, I said I have reasons, right? Well, I used to think there were stars in the swimming pool. Today, not only do I enjoy swimming, but I'm also even in my school swimming pool. I spoke to and trusted God about my fear because I did not want to let it happen. Remember, the Bible told us in 2 Timothy chapter 1 verse 7, for God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and love and of a sound mind. Remember Mary does process from my kids. I want to do something that will take over and that will release. I just need to take care of my kids. But all this is a case for me to be reminded that God wants to experience fear. Well, today we're focusing on procrastination. I'm pretty sure we all procrastinate, or procrastinate to something. I've seen that the number one thing I procrastinate is me. When something isn't in the next day, I don't have the motivation to do it. And when it comes to the time of acting in the next day, I get the support. I think to myself, why didn't I just do what it's basically meant to me? Right now, I'm doing something that's good enough. I should have been practicing to me 2 days ago. I realize that I'm done. I don't press it. And without that pressure, I don't have the motivation to do it. So my first thought to me is to go to the street. Ask God so I have the motivation to do myself. But it's not only about praying to God. The second test, you pray to God to help you pass. But you also have to study. And in my situation, I pray to God and to pray to the solution. I need to remind myself that I'm a student. So there could always be a lot of waiting for me to do that. It's one of the things that so I'd rather do today. But obviously, the loving God can be speaking close to me. Nowadays, I can bring them and bring them to my place to me. Do the things of God, and perhaps in his so, let me in my own mind, accept this critique. If I was in the upset, I would have been used to this.
where this isn't for us. It's only for us. I just really hope it's good to be honest with you. It's not to be all of you that speak to something that has been finding these times to be now, I did the test when I went for the support homework, and I brought the revelation to look at the group. Now, I looked at Philippians chapter 4, verse 13. It says, I can do all things through Christ, him who gave me strength. Amen. Amen. Now, this is the basis of our faith. This is what defines us as Christians. This is what separates us from the rest of the pack, from different religions. As we continue to describe to keep the path. Now, after looking at the word, I decided to quote that to the first piece of the chapter of the other subjects. The B, read the word more often because there's growing confidence in the word. I hope this message is able to encourage you to the next version and touch your heart and plant those three guys into the world.
Thank you, guys. So, before I finish up, I want to read this one verse, which is Psalms chapter 23, verse 4. It says, even though I walk through the darkest valley, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. So, even when you go through the darkest valleys of fear, self-doubt, or regrets, just know that the Lord is with you through each and every part of the world. He will pick you up when you're falling down, and he will continue blessing you, he will continue listening to you, and he will answer your prayers. So, let us cry out to the Lord when the storms in life causes us to experience fear, self-doubt, and regret. Just remember one thing. He, and him himself, Jesus Christ, is the only one who can calm your storm. He is the only one who can calm your storm. Dear Heavenly Father, there's nothing much to say than thank you. Thank you for speaking to us through the word. Thank you for telling us that when we pass through the darkest valley of fear, self-doubt, and regret, you are there to take us and comfort us. It is by your Spirit that we are up here ministering your word, and for that we praise you. Dear Heavenly Father, we ask that you will lead us, guide us, and love us, and we decide to take our own responsibility of faith and trust in you and God. We invite you, Holy Spirit, as we start the journey of taking that one small step and trusting you. We love you, adore you, and preserve you. And we praise you now and forever. Amen.